Sri Guru Vaishnava Guru Parampara ki jai. Grantara Srimad Bhagavat ki jai. So we're continuing our discussion of the Catuh-sloki of Srimad Bhagavatam. This is the second canto, ninth chapter. Tonight we come to verse 33, which is the first of the four verses. We've spoken extensively about the verses already by way of an introduction, and there are two introductory verses to the four, which give a forecast of what's to come. And, of course, what's to come includes not only what's said in the verses, but all that Brahma will realize in terms of their significance through the blessings, the grace of Bhagavan, and through the sadhana, or spiritual practice, that will be recommended. And so we've played that out to some extent, whereas in some depth, where the verses themselves deal in another sense with some very basic points. These points, many of which we've raised, arise out of them, are the implications of them and so forth. But the verses themselves deal with some very basic kind of Gaudiya philosophical points, foundational points that, as I said earlier, make these verses somewhat of a hub, one of the hubs, if you will, that the Bhagavatam revolves around. Other examples of that being the famous Krishna's Tu Bhagavan Swayam, which is one line of one verse in the third chapter of the first canto that speaks about the tattva of the Bhagavatam, that Krishna is Swami Bhagavan. And Rupa Goswami or Diva Goswami is called the Paribas Sutra, the sutra that unlocks the kind of like the password to understanding the tattva of the book, the implication of which is that many verses in the text might appear to say something different than Krishna's Tu Bhagavan Swayam, but given its position, that statement and whatnot, they are to revolve around it and be understood properly in the context of that statement. Another such hub, if you will, as I mentioned, I believe earlier, is the trance of Vyas, which is mentioned in the seventh chapter of the first canto and revealed by Suta Goswami to the sages. What happened to Vyas? What did Vyas experience when he was advised by Narada to sit in meditation and so forth as a remedial measure to his despondency, all of which gave rise to the writing of the Bhagavatam. So if you understand the trance of Vyas there, it gave rise to the Bhagavatam, which is sometimes referred to as Samadhi Bhasha, the language of Samadhi of Vyas. It means also that we have to enter into Samadhi to understand the Bhagavatam, a significant part of the day. And given that his experience is described to some extent, and we see that it's described in very foundational philosophical terms to the overall metaphysic of Gaudiya Vaishnavism, we'd say Achintya Bheda Bheda, and Bhagwan, his Shaktis are mentioned, and so on and so forth, and how they indirect, clearly making it very clear that the text is not about Shakti-less, if you will, Brahman, Nirvishesh, Brahman, Anadvaita Vedanta type of take. It can't be misconstrued to be such if you understand those verses. So that's another hub, and a very practical one. If you want to know what the book's about, how it works, well, let's go to that which gave rise to the book that's described there, Vyasa's trance. And so this is another, these four verses of Krishna to Brahma, and so they are largely a good part of them constitutes kind of a refutation of the idea that ultimate reality is Nirvishesh Brahma. It wants to, the verses posit that the ultimate reality is the variegated reality of the personality of Godhead and his abode and the interactions that take place there that constitute prem bhakti and so on and so forth. And along with that, of course, an explanation of the world as a Shakti of Bhagavan that's very different from, for example, the Advaitin idea of the world wherein the world doesn't exist. It's a superimposition upon Brahman. It's not actually there. And so on and so forth. There's no individual jivas, ultimately, and this kind of thing. So this is largely what it deals with in terms of the sambandha. And as we discussed, there's three topics that the four verses do cover: sambandha, abhideya, and prayojana. And the first two deal with the sambandha. The third deals with prayojana, and the fourth deals with the abhideya. And again, these terms mean, sambandha means relationship. So relational knowledge. We, for example, are defined and understood in the Bhagavatam ourselves in relation to something, not unto ourselves, so to speak. And that, of course, includes knowledge of Bhagavan's form and his Shaktis and how they interact. And then we have the abhideya, which is the means, the kind of activity that the conceptual orientation of sambandha fosters, which is actually bhakti, and then the prayojana is the fruit, the result of acting in a bhakti, out of a bhakti conceptualization and so forth. So we may recall, as we're going to come to the first two verses now tonight about sambandha, we may recall that there is, in the two introductory verses, we heard gyanam paramaguya me yad vijnana samanvitam. We heard that the knowledge that is going to be discussed in these two verses is confidential. It's paramaguyam. Paramaguyam, guyam means secret, so supremely secret, supremely confidential. And knowledge of the form of God, of the personality of God, is like that. It's confidential, very much in the sense that it cannot be known unless it is revealed to us. So it's not, I mean, you can think about it for yourself. I mean, you could be very introspective and arrive at a theoretical and somewhat, I believe, a practical understanding of the idea that you are consciousness, and consciousness is different from the brain or different from matter. As esoteric as that is for your average Kmart shopper or talking head on the television, it's not that hard to arrive at through reason. And now, by contrast, if you want to make an argument for consciousness being independent of matter, which is kind of the 101 of Vedanta, that's one thing. To make from there an argument for the existence of God, and that God is a person, that he has four arms and sometimes two arms and a flute and pastimes, and there's Radha, and you can understand you're never going to arrive at that just by turning your wheels or by very concentrated introspection and so forth. This is something that has to be revealed. So it is confidential. Hmm? It's a secret that that if someone wants to tell us, then we can know. Otherwise not. So he says, Gyanam Paramaguyam. So the Gyanam, there's four things mentioned in that introductory verse. Gyanam, and it's Paramaguyam Gyanam. There's Vigyanam. Hmm? There's Rahasya and Tarangam. Now we discussed these, which to go over in brief. Gyanam means knowledge. Vigyan means realization. Gyan could mean the knowledge of God's opulence, like Narayan. And Vigyan could mean, vi means like special Gyan. It could mean knowledge of the Madhurya of Bhagwan, which is special. Or Gyan can mean theoretical knowledge, and Bhagavan can be saying, and he's saying all these things, I'm going to give you knowledge from the scripture, theoretical knowledge, which is a great, strong, powerful, prominent form of revelation by which your intelligence can become engaged spiritually for knowing something beyond what it could unto itself. So I'm going to give you theoretical knowledge and practical knowledge, which means wisdom of realization that will result from a push which the Shastra gives us, the theory, theoretical knowledge gives us to apply that knowledge and come to realization. Now, another thing, and I didn't mention it, but it's relevant here as we come, especially to the second of these two verses tonight. Vigyan can also mean a special kind of knowledge, as I'm saying, but that could be visheshgyan. It means some knowledge of differentiation between the gyan that corresponds with the form of God. In other words, there's knowledge about the personality of the Godhead, and then there's special knowledge about the relationship between that form of Godhead and his shaktis, visheshgyan. So taking it like this, these two words in the first of the two introductory verses, gyanam and vigyanam, Bhaktivinoda Thakur has seen them to, understands them to apply gyanam to the first of the Catuh-sloki verses and vigyanam to the second. And gyan meaning very confidential knowledge, that means knowledge about the personality of God, that God's a person. And he's the very person who's standing before Brahma and has revealed himself, and so forth. And the vigyan then applies to the second verse of the Catuh-sloki, where the shaktis of Bhagavan and interaction are described. So gyan, vigyan, gyan and visheshgyan. You follow? Then rahasyam is the third word in that first introductory verse. That's a secret. That is prema. And that's the third verse, so it explains the prema. And tadangam, what does tadangam mean? Rahasyam tadangam cha. What does angam mean? No. Limb. So rahasya, along with its secret, what is the secret? What is the limb of prema? Sadhana, which is made up of so many angas, so many limbs. So the fourth verse then is about tarangam, about the sadhana, about practice, and about abhideya, correspondingly. The third verse is about rahasya or prema, which is the prayojan, the goal. The second verse about how the shaktis of Bhagavan, basically the maya shakti, the jeev shakti. And the first verse is about gyanam and that referring to the wonderful and extraordinary knowledge of the personality of Godhead. So the gyan and vigyan is sambandha gyan, knowledge of the form of God and the shaktis and how they interact, in a basic sense. The third verse about prayojan, the rahasya, and the fourth verse about abhideya, tarangam, sadhana bhakti, and its fruit, it's of mature bhakti, like from green mango to ripe mango. So from sadhana to prem. So here he says then in the first verse, aham eva asam eva agre, nanyat yat sad asad puram paschadaham yat etatcha yo vasisheta sosmi aham. So Bhagavan Sri Krishna says here three times in this verse, aham, aham, aham. And aham means I. Our acharyas, dating back to Jiva Goswami, have emphasized and onwards, you know, to present time, this word I, the personal pronoun. Krishna is speaking, and he's speaking about himself, and he says, aham evasam evagre. Before agre, the manifestation of the world, I am. After the world manifests, I am. And when the world becomes unmanifest, I am. And I am alone, he says. It is only me that exists before the world, before anything else. Only I exist. And when it manifests, only I exist. And when it becomes unmanifest, only I exist. It's only me, he says. So this is a very much of an abed emphasis. As you know, in Gaudiya Vaishnavism, our metaphysical worldview has been termed by Sri Jiva Goswami Prabhupada achintya bed abheda. So bed means difference, abed means non-difference. So the idea is there's a oneness and a difference that are inconceivable, and as they permeate, and they interpenetrate, I should say, one another. And not that the Godhead or ultimate reality, let's say, is sometimes one and sometimes different, but they're one. It's one and different at the same time, in a manner in which the two interpenetrate one another, which is logically inconceivable, that you could be immanent and transcendent, to use different terms, at the same time. It could be singular and plural at the same time, that you could be one and different at the same time, that you could be singular and then sometimes you'd have a plural manifestation, and then but to have them both at the same time. And interpenetrating is a little difficult to grasp, so the term achintya is being given to that. And achintya-kalo, what is it? Achintya-kalo, jebhava. It is said certain things are beyond conceptualization, they're achintya. There may be examples by which we can try to explain this oneness and difference. Sometimes the example of fire, heat, and light are given. There's fire and it has heat and light. Heat and light is its energy, so to speak. But here he's saying, I am the fire, and there's only the fire, and in the beginning, in the middle, in the end, there's only me. I. So this is very much a weighing in on the abed side. When we come to the second verse, he'll speak about the bade, the difference side. And to some extent, it carries on into the third verse as well. So we have these two. In a basic sense, there's only God. There's only Krishna. Sometimes people, when we speak about our material conditioning, and it's problematic for us, and we want to know the cause, and we're told, well, you're the cause, or karma's anadi without any beginning. That's just the way it is. Some things will never change. This can change, though. That can change. We're fortunate but that bhakti comes and makes the possibility to change that. Not that it has no beginning, but that it can't have an end. That can be changed. So when we speak about that, sometimes it becomes a little uncomfortable for us. We start to think, well, gee, I mean, I've been in a material existence forever. I didn't have a choice. I just suffer and that's some kind of play of God to bring me out. It sounds torturous in a sense, in the name of play. But of course, that's a very simplistic explanation, but a simplistic take that often people kind of grab onto, instead of gravitating towards a very, like, a metaphysical way of looking at things. But to do that for a moment, one way out of that apparent problem in the heads of some people is to emphasize this particular point, this particular side of the equation, bade obeyed. Obeyed. There's only Krishna. Who's to blame? And we haven't come to the statement that we are his shaktis. That comes next. But despite that we are his shaktis, and in that sense different, we're dependent upon him. And in another sense, from another perspective, we're not different from him. So there's only Krishna. And so who's to blame? Krishna's doing what he does. You have to gravitate towards such a metaphysical outlook. If we go from the other side and we emphasize the abade or the bade, we'll say then it's your fault. You have some minute will, and you're always making choice of some sort, and so on and so forth. So at any rate, here he kind of weighs in on this side of the equation. So with regard to I am, and only I am, before there is anything else, that anything else means the world. And what that's constituted of will be described in the next verse. But when he says only I am, he is speaking about himself and what else? His Swarup Shakti. As I've often said, there are three principal Shaktis of Bhagavan. The Maya Shakti, the Jiva Shakti, and the Swarup Shakti. The Maya Shakti, the Jiva Shakti, and the Swarup Shakti are one with Krishna and different from him at the same time. But some of them are more one and some of them are more different. So the Maya Shakti is more different. And on the other end of the spectrum, the Swarup Shakti is more one. So much so is that the case, that the Swarup Shakti is more one, especially in relation to Krishna, Swayam Bhagavan. Krishna is defined by the Swarup Shakti. The more the Swarup Shakti manifests, the closer we come to Swayam Bhagavan. The more the Swarup Shakti is not manifest, the further away from Swayam Bhagavan and Bhagavan we become. Therefore, in Brahman conception, Swarup Shakti is not functioning there, and Brahman is not dancing. The more the Swarup Shakti, and Bhakti is, of course, constituted of that Swarup Shakti. So the more the Swarup Shakti is in the picture, the closer we come to Swayam Bhagavan, and Swayam Bhagavan is here speaking. So when he says, only I existed, it means, along with my Swarup Shakti, because as Prabhupada used to like to say, Krishna is never alone. He is Swarup Shakti and he are one. They're slightly different, but they're, for example, Radha and Krishna, which are one, in two forms. The love and the object of love, you can't have one without the other. You can't have love without an object of love. And you can't have an object of love without love. So they're inseparable. But nonetheless, they're, they can be talked about as if two, although they're a unit that constitutes one. So when he says here that I alone existed, well, we already know he's shown himself to Brahma. We didn't go over these verses, but there was a revelation, certain different associates of his were there and so forth. In the revelation, Lakshmi was there, he saw a four-armed form and so forth. We've reasoned that now he's manifested as two-armed form. So, but Brahma's seen all these things. So when Krishna says, before everything, the world, which you, in one sense, are the beginning of, Brahma, I existed before all this, and before all that you're going to do with regard to your task of creation, I existed, and there was nothing lacking. It was full and complete, so you wanted me to make sure you didn't become proud. Your whole show is not very significant. He's going to talk about that. The point here I'm making is that he's implying I existed along with my Leela Shakti, my associates, and so we are one. When the Kumaras, to give an example, came to Vaikuntham. And they were not allowed in at first by the gatekeepers, Jai Vijay. Narayan came out of his palace and came to the gate to see what the commotion was. And when he saw and understood what had happened, he said to the Kumaras, "Oh, I have offended you." The Kumaras are very smart. They're big jnanis, so they understood the implication of his statement. When Narayan said, "Oh, I've offended you," they understood these people here, the Jai and the Vijay, the gatekeepers and everybody else, he says they're one with him. Because he didn't offend me, they did. But he said, "I've offended. What my people have done, I have done. They are mine." Ishan and I are one. We're on the same page. So this is the relationship of Bhagawan with his devotees and with the Swarup Shakti. He's much more one with them than different. Indeed, it very much the measure of the manifestation of the Swarup Shakti, the nature of it with regard to the particular of its samvit and ladini, as a corresponding form of Bhagawan. That is the I that he's speaking about. He's not, as Prabhupada used to say, he's not never alone. Bhagawan in his Swarup Shakti, just like in the trance of Vyas, it's very clearly stated the Maya Shakti was there, seen at a distance, the Jiva Shakti, struggling under the influence of the Maya Shakti and so forth. The Swarup Shakti isn't mentioned directly, but it's implied as it is here. And the example is sometimes given, the moon and it shine. Now in 3 days we'll have a full moon, the Purnima here. And so we'll appreciate the moon comes along, the shine comes along with the moon. The moon and the shine are one. And they're a little different too, but they're a package. They come together. So Vyas saw in his revelation, he saw Bhagawan in his brilliance. I mean, he saw him with his Swarup Shakti, and that means with all of his playful leelas and so on and so forth. So Krishna's first I here is emphasizing this point. I exist in my own world, so to speak, under the in conjunction with my Swarup Shakti that governs that world of play and leela, and sometimes another world is manifest, and sometimes it's unmanifest. I'm always there, so there's a yat tad bhashayate suryo nashasham ko napabaka yat gatvana nivartante tad dhamma paramamama, as it is a place of going to from which one never returns. It always is. And then there's a world that comes and goes. Bhutva bhutva paliyate. This coming and going of the world cycles, this is compared to the breathing of the Vishnu. When he says, "I alone exist," it means I as Brahman, I as Paramatma, and I ultimately, as I'm standing before you right now, as Bhagawan. Again, he's not saying, "I exist in a provisional sense," when the world is manifest, as I am standing before you here, and when the world is unmanifest, then I, as you see me now, standing before you, don't exist. There is only Nirvishesh Brahma. He doesn't say that. Vishvanatha Chakravarti Thakura says, he's pointing to his chest like this, saying, I, just as you see me here. He says the same thing in his tikka, in his commentary in the Gita, when Krishna says in, what is it, 7th chapter? No, it's a good one too, but and that parallels this to some extent, the chapter sloka of the Gita, first of the four verses there. Now he says, mama maya duratyaya mame vye prapadyante mayam etam tarantite. He says, my maya is insurmountable. My it's my maya, and it's insurmountable. It cannot be conquered. But those who surrender to me, then it becomes possible for them to. So, Anyway, pointing to his chest, emphasizing himself, as you see me here, I exist when the world of your creation no longer exists. I exist. Before it was manifested, I existed alone. While it exists, when it exists, we have to get to that. I alone exist also. I am the world as well, in a different sense than as the Swayam Bhagavan who transcends the world of comings and goings. This is, of course, the function of the Paramatma, the manifesting of the world, and it's so winding up and so forth. The Paramatma's there, transcendent, he exists. The jivas of the world are there, the Maya Shakti is there too, in a sense, but it's we know that it's in a condition called susupti, where it's kind of closed down and unmanifest. And in a larger sense, as I say, the emphasis here is I with Leela in my Vaikuntha and Golokam, Vrindavan, I exist. I am the ultimate reality. Not as some philosophers like to think, that any manifestation of form representing the God it is something provisional to use for some time, to meditate on, to come to something that's beyond that, that's ineffable and formless and so on and so forth. So again, this is paramakuhyam. This is why this jnanam is paramakuhyam, very confidential and very difficult to grasp. I was saying the other day how Prabhupada used to emphasize that Krishna is a person. He's real. And when someone would say, well, what does it mean, Prabhupada, there were the five horses and the reins on the chariot and so forth, what is this metaphorical implications of all that? He said it takes five horses at least to run a chariot. In other words, he would say, there's a chariot. He had five, there were five horses and there was Krishna and he's there and... he didn't want us to kind of metaphor Krishna away altogether. So that's a very esoteric idea. What Krishna is saying here is reality is a person, and it's me. It's kind of like the Gaia conception of, what is his name, Lovejoy? The scientists some years ago came up with the idea that the Earth is an organism. It's a living thing. And we're, I never studied, but I guess the implication is, and we are, part of that. Like I'm a cell of the earth. And so get out of this human-centric conception of self and see yourself as part of the earth that is the organism that is. And with this in mind, let us live a environmentally correct lifestyle, instead of separating ourselves from the earth and then using it for our purposes. So this must be the implications of his idea, embraced as it was by the environmental community. So, in a bigger sense, reality is a person, it's just not us. We're a person too, but we're a contingent person. We're a dependent person, a dependent entity. We have a will, but it's not independent. In order for it to be fulfilled, activated, bear fruit, or require some sanction. He's saying reality is a person, and it's me. You can see this is quite a turning of heads for our the way we live our lives. We tend to consciously or unconsciously see the world as if it's me, kind of, it's for me, it's I'm the center, so to speak. I'm the subject, as Pujapachita Maharaj used to like to say, and matter's the object, so I'm using it for my purposes. Now we have to turn the other way and see there's a super subject, and as matter appears to be dependent upon me and derive meaning from me. So I am dependent upon and derive meaning from the supersubject. So this is a very different way of living our lives. This is the kind of paradigmatic shift, internal shift, that we're trying to, you know, bring about with like drops of water in the form of sadhana and talks like this on the stone of our hearts that is atrophied, and hardened and pointed in a different direction. Because when we see matter as something to exploit for ourselves and don't look up and see ourselves as something to be exploited for Bhagavan's purpose, as Sridhar Maharaj used to like to say sometimes, using an American phrase, no taxation without representation has no place in bhakti. The Americans said to the British, if you're going to tax us, then we want to be represented in the government. So we're not going to pay any taxes unless the taxpayers have representation in the government and determine what the taxes should be spent for. So this is a foundational kind of, you know, call of the American Revolution. There'll be no taxation without representation. The Americans were a British colony, and they didn't have any representation in the British government, and they were being taxed. But this doesn't apply in bhakti. We can't say to Krishna, hey, you know, if I don't have something to say up there about how you're going to use me, I don't want to be used. This is not how it works. So there's no place for that. He's the autocrat, the despot. He's depicted like he does what he wants. Satya sankalpa. And we think sometimes, I hear people say, I don't really like that idea very much. It doesn't sound like a very all-attractive idea of God. He does whatever he wants, and he's whimsical and a despot and and so on and so forth. Of course, you know, that doesn't speak about it wouldn't be bad to have a dictator if he had a heart of gold, so to speak. And he was, and he dictated and mandated, and was an autocrat of affection. As I said before, the more that the control is a control that arises out of affection, the less the controller will look as such. I'll give an example. If you control someone by physical force, you know you're being controlled. That guy just tied you up. And you want to get out. If someone could control you mentally by manipulating you and so forth, you might not know you're being controlled. You might need a friend to say, come on, get out of there. Get out of that relationship. That's terrible. He's abusing you. And until you get out, you can't quite fully realize it because you're dependent on it. You're getting something from it. You're allowing, and so forth. So the mental type of control is more subtle, but it can be more comprehensive also. You could untie yourself, escape out the window or go under the door or something, but mental control is maybe a little difficult, more difficult. It's more difficult to acknowledge or recognize that you're being controlled, you're being manipulated. It's more subtle. And if we go from physical to control to mental control to control by the heart, I could control you by love. It's impossible to get out of that one. And in that, the wonderful thing is, if I control you by love, that means you love me. Then suddenly you do have representation, in a sense. And you're one with me, and different at the same time. So the point is that the more the controlling is done by affection, by love, the less it appears as a controller. So Krishna's, you say he's a despot, he's the autocrat, he's controlling, and then this conjures up a certain picture like this guy's got, you know, a big army belt or something on him. You see the dictators here in South America, you know, or you know, they're always wearing their army khakis and so forth and that kind of thing. And some of these communist regimes would, on the holidays, you know, parade the missiles through town and the tanks, and you know, we're in control. Just wanted to let you know, isn't it great? and so forth. And so, you know, you talk about he's a despot, whatever he wants, and people go, this doesn't sound very attractive. And then you point, well, this is him, you know, and there he's just playing the flute, and he seems to be controlled by his cowherd friends, by his mother. He's tied up by his mother. Now, how can the guy that's controlling everything, and no one has any say, he says, Bhoktaram jakatapasam sarvaloka maheshwaram. I'm the enjoyer of everything. Everything belongs to me. The implication is nothing for your enjoyment. Nothing belongs to you. It's like I'm starting to choke, you know. And he says, Suridam sarvabhutanam. Those who know this and accept it, they're my friends. Now you become the friend of the person who owns and controls everything, and you can push him over. Yeah, he allows for that. That is the nature of love. So there he is, tied up by his mother. Wrestled to the ground by his friends and so forth, and he's the controller of everything. So you have to look again and see, yes, but by affection's force. And so then the idea of a despot, an autocrat, a dictator, and so forth, which sounds very, for our Western sensibilities of independence and no taxation without representation and rights and so forth, it the idea becomes softened and very, very, very charming and so forth. So at any rate, this idea of the Paramaguhyam, Gyanam Paramaguhyam, that it's the secret knowledge about Krishna, is what we're talking about. He exists alone before the creation, means with his associates, and then the implications, what does he do there, and what is he like, and so on and so forth. Hearing about that, you see, that will be very effective in softening that hardened, atrophied, stone-like heart that has come about as a result of looking at the objective world as if it's mine, and I'm the despot, and I'm in control, and things are just there for my purpose and my value, and I attribute value to them or not, and so forth, and I'm not looking up and seeing, again, myself as a dependent entity. I'm seeing myself as the subject. I'm consciousness. Matter is unconscious. It has meaning. If the car has meaning if I get in it and drive it. No driver, the car has no meaning. Just see how big I am. And then I'm interacting with the objective world in this frame of mind. This makes the heart hard. This makes it like stone. This makes us mean. In other words, this is our meanness. We're taking the world and manipulating it for our purpose. But what is our purpose? Our purpose is that which is conceived in our mind as a result of our sense perceptions, which are very limited in terms of gathering a clear picture of what the nature of being is. And so we got this distorted picture of what reality is, with me kind of in the center. And then I think things should work accordingly to meet my needs and so forth. And the world is somewhat resisting. It's a little uncomfortable living inside your head. It's a little small, to be honest with you. And so we feel there's some resistance, and then we're going to fight with it. And so all this constitutes this hardening of the heart, the atrophying of the heart. Now the task is to soften that heart and chip away. Like I said, drops of water wither away the stone. So with discussions and sadhana and service life and so on and so forth, we want to shift conceptually. One time in Sridhar Mayapur, Navadvip, sitting at the feet of Pujapad Sridhar Maharaj's veranda, one of my godbrothers said, Guru Maharaj, I've come, you know, to the Dham here for a month, and I wonder, like, what service I can do. If I could have some service. Sridhar Maharaj said, well, what did he say? Try to change your angle of vision. And, you know, in terms of, then he elaborated in terms of what I'm talking about. The guy was like, "Sorry, I asked. You know, I just wanted to wash some pots or something. You know, maybe I'd serve prasadam or you know." But you're getting to something that really like, you know, pinching here. That's what that's supposed to be about. In other words, I'm supposed to bringing about a real change in my conceptual orientation. This opens the heart. This softens the heart. And makes room for this paramaguhyam, this very esoteric idea, to come in, and that I'm not the center, that he alone exists. He alone means I'm have no say, really, without his sanction. Just like a tool is mine in my hand to be used as I like, I'm a tool to be used in his hand as he likes. I want to become one with his will. His will is whatever he wills happens. So, hey, can't beat him, join him. Might as well make my will one with his. Then all my will, every desire will be fulfilled. Something like that. So this is very, very foundational idea. And we're trying to like shift the ground here. And every now and then you might get an epiphany. As you make some progress in that, the whole struggle for existence starts to melt and come to an end because that heart is melting. You've made it hard for yourself. Your heart is hard. You're mean. It's no wonder the world's not reacting properly. You're the despot, for God's sake. And so incompetent with your khakis and your military belt and machine gun and so forth. As polite as you can be, you know. Shooting everybody, basically. To take it to extreme, however philanthropic and politically correct you can be, it's impossible to get out of that. That's not going to turn the corner for you. You have to change yourself. It's huge. So, very, very subtle. And you could go on doing all the things of the world with a whole different outview and outlook. And people would think it was just like everybody else. But Vaishnavara Kriya Mudra Vignena Bhujai. It's difficult to understand a Vaishnava. What are his or her motives? How are they looking at the world? It's one thing to interact with the world, but for what purpose and so forth. So this is what Krishna's getting at here. This when he says, I alone existed before the world, before the manifestation of the world, me, my Leela, and I exist when the world manifests, I alone exist. When it's annihilated, I alone exist. It means to say, I am existence. Existence is me, it's a person, it's me, it's not you. And it's me as Bhagwan, and you see me now in my affectionate form. I've shaken your hand. I love you, buddy, my dear friend, like this. This is what I'm like. I'm a person. This is what I'm. It shouldn't be a problem. This, you know, giving up the no taxation without representation, the placards and the protestation and so forth, it can be affected perhaps more readily by the charm. So he not only says it, but he's a charming fellow. Krishna. He's got Brahma in the palm of his hand. He's melted his heart here. Brahma wants to know, what can I do? How do I take advantage of what's happening to me? You're standing before, what are you? what is this all about? He's got him in a very teachable moment. So, I am before the world. And when the world manifests, of course, that we played out in the next verse as he explains the big Ganam. I guess we'll get to that tomorrow, and I thought we'd get to it tonight, but the idea being, the world is me also. It's my Shakti. It's made up of two of my Shaktis, basically. From the abhed, the non-different point of view, world is him, and after the world becomes unmanifest, of course, he continues to be the person that is that reality is. So again, these acharyas have very much kind of honed in on this three times I. It's said three times for repetition, for emphasis. Brahma was taught studied the Vedas three times, and then he proceeded with his task. And so this is often, this idea is used. So three times he mentions our acharyas have found it to be significant in the ways in which I've explained it. Are there any questions?
Yeah. I don't formulate it exactly, but in a sense, like, it's confidential information, but in a sense, it's not a secret. Like, nor is Krishna making it a secret. And it's in different areas of the Bhagavad Gita, and it, why is it presented as a confidential secret? It's not like Krishna's hiding it from the world.
Uh-huh. It's a secret knowledge, as I said, in the sense that if he doesn't reveal it, you can't know it.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
In that broad sense, it's a secret. Mm-hmm. And so without his revealing it, you can't know. That's one thing. But also, it's considered secret in the sense that despite the fact that he does reveal it and make it known, many people don't know it. Hmm? And they don't understand it, and they don't embrace it. And so, therefore, it's thought to be knowledge that's rare, that some people get, assimilate, and some people don't. Hmm? And in that sense, it's confidential. It's not everyday knowledge. It's not the common knowledge. The common knowledge being the knowledge that people are preoccupied with, the knowledge of things and so forth. More confidential knowledge, of course, is the knowledge that you're not the body. Hmm? Now, we could sing it all day long and speak about it and teach it, but the number of people that get it is few, so it's uncommon knowledge. That's why the word Upanishad, the Upanishads deal with that kind of knowledge, the knowledge of Brahman, the knowledge of Atma, hmm? The difference between Atma and the world. But Upanishad means to come, sit close. The idea is that I'll tell you this knowledge that most people are not ready to hear. It's there, it's available. Most people, there's not a teachable moment that's been created in them for them to hear it. They're preoccupied with the lesser conceptions of knowledge, and primarily the gathering of things, which was really in ignorance, and so they don't have a place for this. And so in that sense, it's confidential. It's like a few people have it. Hmm? They can try to give it out all day long, and still they end up with, they don't lose it, but the whole world doesn't become the common knowledge of everyone. And if you go from knowledge of the difference between consciousness and matter, you go to the conception of Bhagwan, the numbers get smaller. Hmm? Then if you go to the conception of Krishna, the Swayam Bhagavan, the numbers get even smaller. And then you get the idea that Krishna is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that the even fewer people. So it becomes more confidential in the sense that it's not common. Hmm. What else?
It's
yes.
A paradox in that it's a secret, and like you said, I can understand it's a secret partly, largely because we're not capable to even desire to know about it as a population in general.
It's also, I should say, confidential in the sense that even if you know about it theoretically, to actually know it...
That was my next point.
...is very rare.
It's being offered like this, but then it's not that simple.
Because it's very confidential. Because mm-hmm. it's very extraordinary.
Fairness,
yeah.
But it's not easy to get a hold of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's like quantum physics or something. Mm-hmm. And times, to the nth degree, something like that. It's like, not the way we ordinarily think about things. Yes, just do it.
thinking Brahma's receiving this at the time of creating the universe, but he doesn't seem to adjust his creation. Still, as the Bhagavatam goes on, we hear that, you know, the avatars come and it's Vishnu Tattva. And I'm just thinking, Brahma's still just overseeing kind of karma and the material energy. So it seems like this is his own revelation, because he needed to know, and he needed the energy to create. He's not like adjusting creation to like get this knowledge out there, or, you know, I mean, maybe as Brahma Haridas, he's Nityananda.
Yeah, well, he has his task. He's a Brahma. He has his task. He has his purpose. His purpose isn't to be an itinerant preacher, and if Brahma took sannyasa, it'd be a problem for the world. He has his business. He's a paradigmatic figure also that represents karma mishra bhakti. Now here, this Brahma is becoming a raganuga bhakta, but he has got one foot in the world, and he's busy with that, and he's trying to dovetail that, and so forth. So he has his task. It's not like he just joined the ashram or something. Brahma just decided to convert and, you know, got a guru and now he's going to leave his post or something like that. That's,
he's using this knowledge as inspiration, and he seemed to have a necessity for it.
Yeah, well, he gets the kama bija, so he has the power to do the work of creation, and in such a way that it will foster the pursuit of the ideal of Prem Bhakti. And of course, Brahma, characteristically, the Brahma gets liberated at the end of his life. This Brahma, of course, didn't, because he had to take birth as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Leela, which is special, because he's not going to go to Vaikuntha. He's going to go to Goloka. But typically, Brahma does, he's a very pious person, and as he's understood paradigmatically, and then he as a figure that represents, you know, like I say, bhakti with some admixture of worldliness, and so he follows the varnashram and it, kind of the system, and then he has bhakti as his ideal, and he completes his work, and then he goes to Vaikuntha. That's the general idea. So he's not like us. Our position is different. Can't expect him to go now. Is he going to go out now and preach? I mean, he said manifest the Vedas. You know, not in a written form, but through the Veda, the world. It's a very esoteric concept of the manifestation of the world. He has his task. He's a god, not like one of us. Avatars come, they broadcast, they teach. Brahma's in his world, you know, what is he doing there? You study the Bhagavatam, Brihat Bhagavatamrita, you see what he's doing in the world, in his Brahmalok. He's worshipping Vishnu there. Now this is a special case for Brahma. He's got the... this is particular Brahma, particular... manifestation of Bhagwan, teaching him in a particular way, giving him Kam Bij, Kama Gayatri, Gopal mantras, as described, for example, in Brahma Samhita, same incident. What else? He has to manifest the world, so Bhagwan can descend in different avatars, and all right, can we stop there? Grantaraj, Srimad Bhagavat ki jai.